Welcome back, everybody. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. It's good to see you all. I hope you all had a wonderful holiday season. If you don't have your group leader, if you're a CLBI student, if you could put your D group leader's name before your name, just so it's easier to put in the breakout groups, or your number, if you're one of the other D groups, please do that. Yeah, tonight we have a special treat. We're going to be hearing from our Minnesota brother and sisters who are, they've been doing their own D group. They joined us online last year when we started doing the 72 for the first time. And they've started their own in-person group. They meet on Thursday nights. So a little bit, they'll be talking about their group dynamic, and then they'll be sharing about more testimony from last week's lesson that Tamara shared about talking with people. So yeah, here we go.
Hey everyone, my name is Alicia Latka.
My name is David Blackstead, and I am a program director at a Bible camp in Minnesota.
It's a little quiet.
Last spring we had the opportunity to be in a small group with Ted Hill and Shalane and a few other wonderful people. Yeah. And that was a really great experience for us. I had some connections to CLBI based on Mount Carmel's history with LBI and Christian Hoff and Jay Niedeloff and stuff. So we were excited to get to know some more CLBI folks. We had a great experience last spring, and then this fall when 72 started up again, we thought we might try and make another small group.
Yeah. So being in Minnesota, one of the main reasons we were thinking about starting our own group was just the time difference got a little bit late for us to stay awake on Wednesday. So we thought, well, why don't we find a group of Minnesotans that, you know, we're in the same time zone and we could just have a community together. We really like the 72, just the messages each week, the community. So we wanted to still be a part of it, but that's how we got the idea to create our own group. So I brought this idea to David. I'm like, we should still do the 72, but let's find some of our friends that might want to do it. So this fall, we brainstormed kind of some people that we thought might be interested, reached out to our friends, and now we have an awesome group that meets every Thursday. And so far, it's been just a really life-giving group where we can grow spiritually and grow in relationship with each other, too. So it's been really fun.
Yeah, it's been great. And now I think we'll hear from Rachel and Stephen.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rachel, and I was invited to join a discipleship group with the 72 by Alicia and David back in October. I pretty much just knew Alicia when we started, but now I feel like I know the rest of our group really well and that we can all trust each other because we've been able to share openly, encourage each other. And I didn't really know that much about the 72 before starting, but I really love the mission of the group. In December, Paige in our group asked the question, is there a situation in which you want to invite God into, and how can we support you in that? And I remember answering that I had kind of been avoiding God lately, that I wanted to really sit down with him the next week and ask him if there was a way I could serve him or maybe a specific person I could pour into. And then that Sunday, I was sharing this with a friend from my church, and she said, you know, I think there is someone already right in front of you that you're not realizing. And I was like, who do you mean? And she went on to tell me that there was a teacher who had just joined my kindergarten team that year who I'd kind of just told her about. And she said that, you know, it seems like she likes to ask you for advice, and she's been coming to the prayer group at your school. Like, do you think that could be the person God's leading you to pour into? And I was like, wow, like, how did I not even notice that was right in front of me? So I ended up asking my coworker, and now we've met twice to go through Bible passages together. And so I'm just grateful for how God has worked on my heart through this group. And I'm seeing that God doesn't necessarily call us to big, crazy things all the time, but often things that might be right in front of us if we're able to slow down and let him show us, and then just having the accountability in the group to really check in to see if I am listening for God's voice in my life. So thank you for listening.
Hey,
What's going on, everyone? My name is Steven, another member of the Minnesota 72, and glad to be sharing a little bit about my group experience within our little D group. And thank you to Rachel, David, and Alicia for already sharing throughout this video. So, really quick, the one dynamic that I want to share with you all has been an interesting combination of vulnerability and growth. And so our group, we are made up of 7 different members, 5 of them being in the Twin Cities metro area, and then 2 others being in Alexandria, Minnesota, which is about 2.5 hours away from the cities. And so every week we meet virtually. And so this is something maybe by the end of the year we can have one in-person meeting. That'd be cool. But in the meantime, we're virtual. And so what this has created for us, one, if you can think back to your first few days learning Zoom, and you're like, huh, okay, so what are the social dynamics here? Like, when do I have my mic muted? When do I have my video on, off? I don't want anybody to see me. And so a little bit of that going on. And also this dynamic of everyone in the group is either friends with somebody, they knew somebody personally and well in the group, and then everybody else was like a friend of a friend. So like, oh yeah, I know you because of this. We were at the same birthday dinner a couple months ago, or you worked at Mount Carmel 2 years before me, and we like crossed paths a few times, but like never actually got to really connect. And so it was this interesting dynamic of, you know, that everybody in the group is legit, we'll go with that term, you know, but you didn't actually have those personal connections that you could fall back on just to immediately start conversation. And so as we started to go through sharing and working through the books, this interesting dynamic of not quite understanding how to be completely vulnerable off the bat. There was an understanding that there was a safe space, but there was still a little bit of a hesitancy of, I don't know this group completely well, so therefore I am going to maybe lay back a little bit. I think all of us had moments where we're like, all right, how are we doing this? How are we doing this, you know? And so as the year has gone along and we've gotten more comfortable with each other and almost learned like, hey, like we, you know, this is something we could have been sharing, you know, right from the get-go, but that's not quite how we learn to interact with each other. But it's been a really cool blessing to move kind of from maybe the Christianese, so to speak, that we fall back on as a crutch in some of these situations, to now saying, like, this is something that I can say for myself personally, I really look forward to on Thursday nights, and I know everybody else does as well. And we've really learned how to interact with each other in a way that is healthy, that is respectful of one another's experiences and views, that it truly is a safe space, and it's something that has become mutually beneficial for all of us. And so very, very grateful for the group. Thanks, CLBI, for allowing us to have the group, and certainly we're looking forward to what 2021 is going to bring with us and the movement as a whole. So what we are focusing on this week is testimonies through our application of talking with people. And so if we can think back to the last time that we gathered, we had a wonderful explanation of introverts and extroverts from Tamara and how exactly those two different types of people are going to engage in talking with people. And so this week we're continuing on with the application and the testimony, so real life experiences of how exactly we do talk with people. And so I'm going to be doing that for us today. So I wanted to share 2 types of examples that I've come across in my experience with talking to people, and then as well as 1 metaphor that I have found helpful in how I approach and view those conversations retrospectively. And so the first type of conversation that I tend to come across is the type of conversation where one particular moment leads to another moment, which leads to another moment, and so on and so forth. And so I used to work for a law firm called the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland in Cleveland, Ohio. I was a legal assistant, so working with administrative stuff as well as the tax department. And so one of the people that I worked with at the Legal Aid Society, his name was John, and so we were just 2 cogs in the machine at first. He was a retired lawyer, and I was just hanging out, new guy in the block, whatever. We worked together whenever we had to and then kind of went our separate ways. But then as we developed a little bit more of a comfort with one another, we began to share a little bit more about what was going on in our personal lives, personal views, how we got to where we were in Cleveland, all that good stuff. And so as I began to develop this relationship with John, I would never necessarily just full on share all of my views, particularly as they related to Christianity, Jesus, whatever. And it was just every single moment that I had the chance to say, oh, yeah, you know, I worked at a Bible camp for a summer, or, oh, I took a gap year after high school and I traveled with the music ministry team, whatever that was. Or maybe it was, this is where I go to church locally. You know, stuff like that. And so John and I began to develop this relationship where I could tell that he trusted me more and more because I was simply willing to share what my experience was as it fit into the conversation that we were having. I think sometimes we can, if we overshare a little bit, you tend to see this from people. They draw away because they can tell that maybe we're pushing a little too much, and maybe they think, oh, there's like an agenda this person wants to get across to me versus just engaging in conversation is whatever answer fits the question perfectly or whatever makes sense. You know, maybe perfectly isn't the right word to use, but more so an answer that fits the question, and the other person doesn't have to, you know, ask a follow-up question. It's just, oh, yeah, that's it. That works. Cool. And so John was a great example of just one moment leads to another, and just seeing where Jesus takes that relationship. And I'm very grateful to still be friends with John to this day. He was actually a great help in helping me set up some bylaws for an organization that I'm a part of called the Awaken Project, and that was great. John had a lot of experience where I had no experience, and so thank you, Jesus, for setting up that relationship, maybe for the production, but more so I would just hope for, you know, the gospel presentation. And then the other type of conversation is not necessarily one moment that leads to another, which leads to another in terms of you and another person consistently interacting with one another, but actually the opposite, which is just one moment, right? And so the moments that I can think of that were maybe a little bit more sporadic, they weren't connected. It was the moments, and that was it. And so I lived at a house my last year of college. We had a wonderful front porch at the house. It was a great place just to have conversation. Towards the end of the day, you just sit outside with your buds, with your friends, whoever's walking down the street, maybe they come up and chat for a little bit, and the conversations were, you know, whatever was going on at class or sports or, you know, maybe some bigger things. And there were a couple opportunities where I could at least share, you know, parts, pieces of my faith and eventually get into gospel conversations. And maybe it was, you know, like a full conversation that we tore apart. Like, you know, someone tweeted something and we just went one after another. But that was all still, you know, encapsulated into one moment. Or maybe it was just, oh, Stephen, what do you think of this? You know, you're a Christian. What do you think of that thing that one person said? And then I'd share my piece and maybe that's all they wanted to hear. You know, but each of those moments on the porch, it was just still exactly that, one moment. And very rarely were they ever really connected into follow-ups. And so a lot of times I'd catch myself thinking, God, like I want to know where that's going with that person. I want to know why their heart was open in that particular moment in time. And, you know, honestly, I will never have the chance, maybe once I get to heaven, but certainly on this side of heaven, I don't know if I'll ever know. You know, and that's something that I need to have peace with. And so both of those types of conversations, whether it's something that you can consistently see, oh yeah, I see this person on a regular basis, and so therefore I can maybe be a little bit more prepared and expecting these moments to come and conversation to continue, see where it goes. Or I just need to be prepared. I need to have, you know, an answer for my faith, whatever that might be in this moment. It doesn't need to be perfect, but it needs to be where you are at the moment, you know. And so a metaphor that I love to use when it comes to having these kind of conversations is where do these moments fall if you think of links in a chain, right? So thank you to Dean Swenson. That's actually David Blackstead, a member of our group. That's his grandfather, a wonderful figure for the gospel. We're very grateful to still have him here on this earth. But he taught me this one metaphor a few years ago. Just think of these kind of conversations as links in the chain. So whether that's one moment or quite literally a chain of moments, they all connect together. And so each link in a chain, it's not necessarily more important or less important than another link. However, if one link is taken away from the chain, the whole thing is disconnected. You may have two parts, but it's not one continuous story anymore. And so that helps me recognize, one, that maybe if I'm simply just getting to know somebody at a coffee shop, that's a good moment. That's a link in the chain. It's important and it matters to Jesus. Or if I'm at the point now where I'm able to share the gospel with somebody, that's an important moment too. You know, that's, you know, a big part of the Great Commission, but it's still a link in the chain, you know. And either moment shouldn't necessarily be scary to the point where we don't feel like we're able to engage in that moment. But we can have trust and faith in knowing that Jesus is with us in those moments and that each is an important part of the journey, whether that just be initiating the conversation, which for some people that might be really scary, but it's, you know, it's still important and it can be done. And also sharing the gospel, which other people maybe think that is really scary. But Jesus is still with us in that moment and there is still work that can, will be done for the kingdom, which is fantastic. And so as we go into our group tonight, I just encourage you all to think about where exactly you find yourselves, whether that be a link in somebody else's chain or how maybe people are approaching you and how they're going to fit into your chain. And remember, these chains are not things necessarily that we're going to carry with us. They shouldn't be a burden, but rather they're attached to the anchor that is Jesus Christ, you know, and how exactly these chains are the things that we can use, we can see, we can visualize as the journey of our faith, our walk, and how every single piece is connected together. And so I find it helpful to maybe think a little bit more linearly, just that one piece is connected to another and not trying to attach multiple chains. That's just the way that I think maybe it's helpful for you as well. But as we go into our groups, I pray that there is honest conversation, that we can be vulnerable and that we can just be present in this moment with each other and wondering maybe where the next link in the chain is going to come tonight. So thanks for listening, everybody, and blessings on your group time.
Thank you to those of you in Minnesota who will probably be watching this tomorrow for sharing. Before I send you off into your groups, myself and a few other of the people kind of in leadership for the 72, we're discussing having kind of a community WhatsApp group chat. So if you're a member of the 72, please give your small group leader, be that Brandt or Lauren and Rhonda or Ellie, your number today and download WhatsApp so that we can have kind of community chat that we can use for prayer requests, discussion, and questions, whatever else. So yeah. And if that sounds annoying to you, you're allowed to mute it and look at it time to time too. That's fine. So I will be sending you guys off to your small groups. God bless you, and I'm glad to be able to see you all.